Well, she's famous for being Princess Mary of Denmark's best friend and bridesmaid, but that is far from the most interesting part of Amber Petty's story. After a string of disastrous relationships, the former radio host fell victim to an elaborate catfishing scam that rocked her to her core and put her self-belief to the ultimate test. And Amber joins us now. It's nice to see you, Amber Petty.
It's nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure. Now, in your new memoir, you reveal that you were actually a little bit sad at your best friend Mary's wedding. Why is that?
I was really sad. You know, our relationship was really special to me and precious to me, and I guess now, you know, I see that I really wasn't in a good space, and I always felt that that friendship brought me a lot of light and security because she was sort of very anchored and probably a little bit more sensible and grown up than I was. And so in a way that, there was just this sort of, like, dynamic that I felt that I really needed. And I don't think at the time Sydney was a really great place for me. And I was working in the music industry, so that was sort of, you know, not the ideal environment to sort of, like, you know, peace out and also heal a broken heart, which I did because I'd come out of a long-term relationship not long after meeting Mary. So... I was really grieving, to be honest, and it felt like everyone was so excited about this fairy tale, which, of course, I had to, you know, play into with everyone going, yeah, I know, it's amazing, it's amazing. But I didn't feel amazing. I felt like there was a huge ending, and that, for me, was just, it was pretty painful. I don't think I recognised it as grief, and that's the thing that I really want to share too, that I think... You know, grief isn't always about someone dying. It's about endings. And so the ending of our friendship in terms of what it had been, hanging out on, you know, sitting on her bed, talking for hours like lots of girlfriends do, and I think a lot of girls can relate to that friend or, you know, those friends. And when that's removed, it's a really big loss. And I was definitely grieving and then grieving in the spotlight. And then, of course, I really wasn't looking after myself because you sometimes try and throw yourself out. Oh, I've been invited to this fabulous party. I'll go to that. That's great. But it wasn't good for me to heal myself. And as a highly sensitive person, it was actually the worst thing I could have done.
As an interesting thing is the world watched Mary go on to the fairy tale and live in the palace and have four beautiful children and all the rest. Your love life wasn't going quite so well, to put not too fine a point on it.
Yeah.
Went on Celebrity Survivor.
Yes.
And you met not the Australia, not the Channel 10 version, I have to say, on some other channel.
Yeah.
But you met one of the crew members, and that turned out to not be a great relationship. It was abusive.
Yeah.
And your self-esteem went down.
Yeah,
down the toilet.
It was really terrible. You know, I think the thing is, I think any woman has a level of wanting that fairy tale, because we're kind of programmed as children that there's a fairy tale, so you've got to look out for it. And what is that going to look like? Is it the banker? Is it the, you know, gorgeous farmer? Like, whatever it is. But I was in, like, this literal so-called fairy tale. You know, and in many ways it was, because they're madly in love and still are madly in love. But, of course, it's this royal princess thing. It's this out-of-the-page books. And so I was really drowning in the concept of fairy tale. And so, you know, with my low self-esteem, I think I went looking for my fairy tale in all the wrong places. And, in the book I obviously share two very, very horrific relationships I had, and one of it which did end up, you know, violent. And I didn't grow up with violence by any stretch. And I found myself in this violent relationship, and I just was shell-shocked. I just didn't even know, how did I get into this place? How has this happened? It was really awful. And I didn't want to tell anyone. I was embarrassed.
Did you not tell Mary what had
happened? No,
because on one hand, on the other side of the world, she actually has Prince Charming.
Yeah.
And you get toad after toad, and you're not, you know, you're kissing these frogs and they're not turning into princes.
Yeah.
How do you pull yourself back out from that thing?
Well, I remember very significantly, firstly, in terms of people, my close friends like Mary and other close friends, they didn't know what was going on. They didn't know how bad it was. I'm sure they suspected he may not have been the greatest guy and I may not have been in the greatest space, but they definitely didn't know to the level. So it's actually been quite confronting because those close girlfriends who have now read the book before it obviously was published and you know, may not have been the final version, have all called me quite distressed because they have all felt like they should have known that they somehow failed me. And it's been very upsetting because I don't like to see them upset, and I just have had to really work hard to let them know I kept that from you. You did not fail me. I kept that from you. Yeah.
I read the book in one sitting over the weekend.
That's amazing.
It was absorbing. And I just could not believe what I was reading about this catfishing scheme.
Oh, my God.
Where you were presenting on Adelaide radio.
Yeah.
And your co-host pranked a Canadian woman called Sarah. She later revealed she had cancer and you developed an online friendship. And then after she died, her best friend came to stay with you.
Yeah.
Can you reveal what you later discovered?
Yeah. So this woman basically targeted our show. She was from Canada. It started out on our show as a gotcha call that was done by my co-host at the time, Rabbit, and he pretended he was an immigration officer. She was pretending she was this young, loved-up, you know, 26-year-old yoga instructor who was marrying a local guy. And so, you know, the phone call was, you know, one of his usual gotchas. You know, some of them I thought were funny, some of them I thought was a bit, you know, cruel. But this particular one started this, you know, it was presented as, a, you know, this fabulous love story. It ended in giggles and the usual sort of thing. But later she stayed friends with Rabbit and she later revealed that she was dying of cancer. So then we ended up doing this, you know, piece on air about this girl, and our listeners all kind of were so, you know, heartbroken about this tragic love story that they ended up, you know, donating all of this money. Cut a long story short, after that point, she reached out to me and we ended up with our own personal friendship. She then dies months later. I'm really heartbroken. I realise it's weird that I'm heartbroken. Not heartbroken, but I was very sad. You know, I realised I hadn't met her before. But before she died, she introduced me to her best friend. And from that point, over a period of nearly 6 months, this best friend who's claimed that she was an executive producer on one of the biggest shows, nightly shows in Canada, that she was coming to South Australia and she wanted to spread the ashes of her best friend. During also this time before she gets to Australia, she introduces this sort of, you know, oh, my, you know, my sidekick writer, who's, of course, this handsome single guy and who sends flowers to me on my birthday because, you know, he ends up sort of contacting me through this sort of, you know, harmless sort of thing. Anyway, cut a long story short, this woman came and stayed with me in my house. She came into the radio station. She met everybody. She thanked them all for, you know, all the donation money and, you know, how much, you know, how sweet we'd been to her dying friend. I went down the beach with her. She spread the ashes out at sea of this dying, the dying best friend. I then went to Perth with her and I did realise from the minute I met her, I picked her up at the airport. I mean, it is like a black comedy, isn't it, Angela? Like, it's tragic, but it is funny as well sometimes.
I'm just going to bury the lead.
Yeah.
But none of that was true.
No, none of it was true. It was this girl. That's right. It was the best friend. She'd created all of these characters.
Nobody had died of cancer.
She did the voices of the dead friend consistently right through to I'm now days away from dying friend. And then there was the tough best friend, which of course physically presented as her. There was about five different characters she designed in emails and they were brilliant in their consistency.
Unbelievable.
And, yeah, so I had to play detective at the back end and, of course, I found out one by one that none of these characters existed. And then the final straw, which was really horrific for me again, was finding out that this girl that I genuinely kind of, you know, fell for in terms of her story and what a sweet girl and that she died and, you know, I'd grieved to a certain extent, never, ever existed. And it was the final punch in the stomach for me because, actually, I'd put myself on a 12-month love ban before this story entered my life because I'm like, my attitude was, I'm attracting these people. I need to investigate myself. I'm not going to sit here as a victim. There's something wrong with me. So I was doing all this healing. But, of course, the loophole of I'm not getting involved in any love story was getting involved in someone else's. Mm-hmm. So it was the old universe testing me. And, of course, I plunged into that, sidetracked on my own healing. and ended up getting pulled into something that wasn't, of course, physically violent, but it was really so dark and actually could have been horrific. The girl slept in the bedroom next to me.
Oh, God.
God knows what she could have done. It is an intense book, isn't it? But
yes,
hopefully there is some funny black comedy. Like,
yes,
I do laugh at a lot.
I read that they're already looking at making this into a TV, a miniseries,
well,
or a movie. Who
a
would play you if it gets to Hollywood?
I don't know. I wouldn't want to say, because then people will think that I'm a total idiot.
Go on.
Look, a couple of years ago, one of the biggest talent agencies, I shouldn't say who they are, but I think they look after Angelina Jolie and all these screenwriters, heard about the story through this American guy, and they came sort of knocking and wanted a meeting. There are some people sort of sniffing around about the story. I feel like it could be a doco, because I feel this girl is still out there potentially preying on people, and that doesn't sit well with me. But then I think it definitely could make it almost a... What's that, you know, Samantha Applegate? Christina Applegate?
Yes, Christina Applegate.
What's that? Is it Dead to Me? I feel like it's got... It could be a Dead to Me vibe. Like, it's really awful, but it's also kind of funny. That's how I see the story.
And if you don't like, you'll cry. What is next for you then? Because, you know, you don't want to forever be the bridesmaid.
No.
Do you want to be a bride one day? Do you want to find love?
Do you know
and
what?
Is it on the horizon? Or
I definitely think I'm at a point in my life where I would definitely like a partner. I think also COVID, even though I had a good year and I was very grateful that nothing dramatic happened to me and whatever, in my own, I'm very good at being on my own, but I definitely have realised that I think I would like to, you know, a partner. Marriage is still... So I grew up with fairly toxic beliefs around marriage because my parents' relationship was a disaster and it was all done by the time I was a baby. But so I'm not... Marriage and religion is not my thing. But that's not to say that if I fell in love that I wouldn't suddenly want to be a little bit more traditional, you know. I think the man that I will end up with, if he's out there, will probably be a bit old-fashioned like my grandfather was. So... Yeah, I'm definitely open, but I'm always okay on my own.
You're holding out for your own prince.
Yeah.
Of sorts.
Yeah, exactly. Of sorts.
Done your share of frogs.
Oh,
your time has come.
It's been like cans on a bad hot night with frogs. The big and small frogs have been everywhere.
That's brilliant. Amber Petty's memoir is called This Is Not a Love Song. It's intense. It's a great read. Amber, thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much, and thank you for reading my book.
Of course.
I really appreciate it.
Hopefully we'll see it on the big screen very soon.
Yes, wouldn't that be good?